Fonda falling in love with Robert De Niro in Stanley and Iris. James Belushi and Whoopi Goldberg are a couple of misfits in Homer and Eddie. And Detective Gene Hackman has never had a partner like Dan Aykroyd in the comedy Loose Cannons. It's all coming up next on Siskel and Ebert.
Until he was 50. He likes to have me around.
Does he get along with your wife?
I don't have one.
Robert De Niro and Jane Fonda are working class people who meet and fall in love and discover some problems in Stanley and Iris. It's one of the new movies we're going to be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is Stanley and Iris, and it's a well-intentioned but sappy drama about a man who can't read or write, has been hiding it, but learns how through the efforts of a woman who loves him. Jane Fonda and Robert De Niro play bakery workers in a small industrial town. She discovers that he can't read, and after he's been fired from his job because of it, he reluctantly talks to her about being illiterate.
He can't take a bus. He can't read where it's going. You can't drive a car because you can't get a license. You ask yourself, have I got a name if I can't write it? Am I a human being if I can't read it?
He's single. She's recently widowed with two young children. He's attracted to her, which makes his asking her for help that much more difficult.
Do you have any spare time?
Not much, but what's on your mind?
Well, I thought maybe... I'll talk to you some other time.
I didn't believe Jane Fonda for a minute in this film. She seems so earnest, such a goody-two-shoes.
This sentence tells what the girl has in her hand. Read it.
The girl has fish in her hand.
Good.
Naturally, Fonda's tutoring does have a positive effect. Here's another overwritten scene.
And though spirit... And the Spirit of God hovered over the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light.
Amen.
Now, when you have the great Robert De Niro and you have Jane Fonda in a movie written and directed by the same team who made Norma Rae, I think it's reasonable to ask for a little subtlety in this film. But instead, Stanley and Iris is written and played, at least by Jane Fonda, as a TV disease movie of the week. It's all problem, solution, end of movie. Why not make some part of the experience really tough, especially the learning how to read and write? This film got me angry because illiteracy is an important subject, and I think they blew it with a much too obvious film.
Well, I agree with part of what you say. First of all, the reading and writing part of the movie is utterly unconvincing, including some problems in continuity, where at one point he can read better than he can later in the film. That disturbed me. I also wasn't convinced that we were looking at a learning process.
Right,
I think now, this is the strangest thing about this movie. I think the weakest thing about this movie is its subject. Illiteracy. I know that's why they made the movie. I wasn't interested in it because they didn't make me interested in it. What I was interested in was the relationship between Stanley and Iris, and I disagree with you in what you say about Jane Fonda. You didn't like her or you didn't believe her or something.
No, not at all.
I feel Fonda created a character that I could recognize from people that I had met and that I respected and that I liked. I liked their chemistry with each other. I did not like the illiteracy subtext. I didn't like any of the scenes having to do with illiteracy because they didn't convince me nearly as much as all the other scenes. It's very strange that a movie that its weakest point would be the thing it was allegedly about.
Well, you're right. As you're watching him learning, you don't really think he's learning.
No.
And that the either the terror of it, the sequences aren't written. De Niro can play just about anything, it would seem. So you have to look at the material. There aren't scenes written to show either the terror or the stretching or the recidivism of, you know, it's easier just to hide. I'm not going to, you know.
No, there is that scene in there where he's.
I mean, but it doesn't.
Says he's gonna drown.
I know, but it isn't compelling, is what I'm saying. There really isn't a drama there. With Jane Fonda, I am finding, and also with Old Gringo, that the roles are so earnest and good, so heroic, that I think that she's like on a talk show doing these roles.
There have been actors and actresses since time immemorial who have been typecast in certain kinds of roles, and this is the kind of role that Jane Fonda feels, I think, most at home with. I think that she does a good job with
it. I think that the role...
I'm giving the movie thumbs down, but only because of the things I've talked about. I think that you're way too hard on Jane Fonda, and that the relationship between Stanley and Iris here is the best thing in the film.
I think that the picture that she did that will remain the best of her career is Clute, and she was playing a tough cookie and a hard woman rather than this great hero.
Okay,
more interesting for me.
Next movie, and our next movie is another bittersweet love story about a mismatched couple. This one is called Homer and Eddie, and it stars James Belushi as a mentally retarded man who wants to travel across the country to visit his dying father. And the co-star Whoopi Goldberg is an escaped and homicidal mental patient who gives him a lift. At first, Goldberg only wants to rob Belushi, but eventually, they become friends.
You know, I never had a friend like you before, Eddie.
Not even when you were a kid?
Especially when I was a kid.
On the road, they visit a brothel where Goldberg wants to treat Belushi to a freebie.
Get off, you're in the presence of Lee. Come on. Eddie? Yeah. It's me. This is my cousin Esther. She is the greatest.
Turns out that some of Goldberg's problems are physical as well as emotional. She's dying of a brain tumor.
We could have been friends, Eddie. We could have been friends forever.
Not forever, Homer. For a month.
No.
For 1 month. I'm dying, Homer.
Belushi has an unshakable faith in God and persuades Goldberg to try going to confession. Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. I've killed 3 people, only 1 recently.
But, you know, I'm real sorry about it. Really. Because, you know, I didn't want to grow up to kill anybody.
Now, Homer and Eddie is the kind of movie that helps illustrate why I like Stanley and Iris. This movie presumably
what a compliment.
Means well, but it carries such a heavy load of would-be significance and overwrought melodrama that collapses under its own weight. Now, I've heard of movies that want to tug at your heart, but this one stages a tug of war with the retardation and the mental illness and the parents that don't care and the dying father and the brain tumor and the murdered convenience store clerks and the heart-to-heart talks that punctuate all of these developments with lines like, you know, you're my best friend. Individual scenes in the movie are fairly good. I liked all of the details in that visit to the brothel, for example, and I liked some of the chemistry between Belushi and Goldberg, but the movie finally just sinks under the burden of all the different things it's trying to do. It's like an explosion at the screenplay factory.
Yeah, I mean, it's ludicrous.
Yeah.
It really is. I mean, you're just sitting there saying, you know, why can't they have... Maybe it's more difficult to write sequences where your two leads are alone together and not all of these things are happening to them. I bought from time to time Jim Belushi and his character.
He does some nice things.
I thought so.
There are
some mannerisms where you say it's a little bit over the top, but basically I could handle him because he was restrained.
Mm-hmm.
Whoopi Goldberg is, I was watching Whoopi Goldberg. Not once did I think she was in character, or in any character other than one I've seen. Did you really find her at any time?
I could more or less accept her, yes. I didn't find that the performances were the problem nearly so much as the script, which just threw everything at us. I mean, by the time she came up with a brain tumor, what's going to happen next? Is she behind on her mortgage payments too, or what?
Or is she a shoplifter or something? I mean, as well. You know, I mean, it's when they do that, they really deny the drama of the thing that they're talking about. I mean, you don't really think it's a brain tumor, and so then you start to resent and dislike the picture intensely. Coming up next, a cop buddy picture called Loose Cannons, teaming Gene Hackman with Dan Aykroyd. Of Weird Balls. Our next film is called Loose Cannons, and following on the success of the Lethal Weapon movies, it's yet another cop buddy picture with a mixed pair of detectives. Gene Hackman plays the veteran cop. Dan Aykroyd plays a literal nutcase, shell-shocked by violence. He's got a brilliant investigative mind, but he spent the last 2 years in a mental hospital.
Then, 2 men chased the fat man dressed as the Queen of Hearts, but he got away. Someone tormented the German gentleman who was dressed as the Cheshire Cat. He taunted him from here all the way over to here, then shot him here where the body was found.
They're assigned to solve some murders involving the pursuit of a rare Nazi film purporting to be a porno film involving Adolf Hitler. That's sort of distasteful. The trail takes them to a bar where the incipient violence causes Aykroyd to freak out with movie imitations.
You gotta ask yourself one question. You feel lucky, punk, do you? Do you?
Out of the west, through a cloud of dust, with a hearty hi-yo silver, rides the Lone Ranger with his faithful Indian companion, Tonto.
Yes, another hackneyed bar fight. Along for the ride in pursuit of the killers is Dom DeLuise playing a porno king. Hackman's upset because Aykroyd is destroying Hackman's classic woody car.
What are you doing to my car?
Welcome to the NASCAR driving school. Anybody can learn to drive a stock car with our patented technique of teaching.
This is an amazingly bad film. The boys also run across an Israeli secret agent, Nancy Travis, who also wants the Nazi film. Not too witty dialogue here.
Attaché Israeli Embassy. Attaché spelled Mossad.
Mossad.
Israeli Secret Service.
Oh, that's my people. I'd like to apply for political asylum right now.
This is truly ludicrous. Hackman isn't given a distinctive character. Aykroyd's character makes the film a farce, which undercuts the thriller aspect. The case that they're on is absurd. I didn't find anything to like about Loose Cannons, and I'm very surprised to find Gene Hackman and Dan Aykroyd in this,
with this
script.
It's a complete dismal mess. Now, come on now. Isn't Stanley and Iris looking better and better as the show goes on?
That is not a compliment to Stanley and Iris, compare it to Loose Cannons.
I've got to admit. Now, this movie is a complete mess, and it's got all kinds. For example, why is a bar in a cop movie?
To have a fight in.
Why is Dom DeLuise in a cop movie? In order to play Dom DeLuise, that's right. One of the real weak points in this film is that Dom DeLuise is always playing himself so that you can never believe that he's the character, and so therefore it's like a guest star kind of role. It's like television, you know, where somebody comes in and says, hi, I'm Dom DeLuise, and then everybody knows it, but they don't say it because they pretend that he's somebody else. As for the Aykroyd characterization, where he's doing Tweety Pie and Sylvester and Pee Wee Herman and all of these other things, that is completely off-putting. It's like some kind of a vaudeville act that's shoved into the movie every 5 minutes for no purpose.
I was thinking about that. You know why they write characters like that? Because, think about it, these are movie industry writers, okay? Mm-hmm. So what do they know? They know movies and they know TV, because that's what they grew up on. Mm-hmm. And so in an urban setting, in a cop thing, they put in that character trait. Mm-hmm. It's totally inappropriate. It's just what they know about.
There's another thing about this movie. This porno movie that allegedly stars Hitler shows him, allegedly,
yes,
in compromising circumstances with a politician who is now going to be the next chancellor of West Germany, unless this film, of course, is shown, in which case his prospects would probably be dimmed. Now, one of the things that bothers me is that to this day, it's absolutely routine in the movies for today's Germans to be dismissed as a bunch of neo-Nazis. You know, and there's the conviction that the Nazis are really still behind Germany. I can't think of any other ethnic group or any other nationality group that is so routinely slandered in respectable circles with no protest.
Oh, I think that there are plenty of other groups that get it. The Arabs get it all the time. People from the Middle East in terms of terrorists, I think they're probably the easiest ones. I just saw a film set in Mexico where all the Mexicans are fat, sloppy, vulgar, beer drink. I mean, the movies, when they deal with any ethnic group, tend to deal in broad stereotypes.
Okay, when we come back, one of the most talked about movies of recent months, a strange import from Australia named Sweetie.
I can't believe it.
And it tells the story of a very strange Australian family, a family that has a lot of problems and none of them more complicated than the personality of the youngest daughter, nicknamed Sweetie. She's been coddled and spoiled by her dad ever since she was a child, and now she's grown up into a monster, as her sister and her sister's boyfriend discover when they come home one night.
Rive, what are you doing here? You know you're not allowed. You broke the bloody window. I'm really mad at you.
It wouldn't open, Kay. It was really stiff.
Of course it was. It was locked.
That's Genevieve Lemon in a brave and affecting performance as Sweetie.
So, Sweetie's doing all right, eh?
Are you kidding?
I'll give her a go, okay? This could be what we've been looking for her.
John Darling plays her dad, who wants to believe in her. He really does. The pathetic thing about Sweetie is that she still lives in a fantasy world where she's the center of attention.
Here's the flipping eye for herself.
When Sweetie doesn't get her way, there's trouble.
Well, she hasn't been eating.
We've been looking forward to seeing you, sweetie.
What are you doing? Dawn, what is it? Stop it, Dawn. Stop it now.
Sweetie is the first feature by a young Australian director named Jane Campion, who has a weird and completely original way of looking at things. The movie isn't a satire, really. It's more of a horror story about how the Australian dream came unstuck and left Sweetie hanging out to dry. The movie uses deadpan, sick humor to make some of its points and then sticks in some absolutely normal people doing absolutely normal things to make us ask, who's crazier? One of the things I liked about Sweetie was the visual look of the film, Campion's way of framing things to make us think about them in more than one way at the same time. You can't just sit back and let this film happen to you. You have to participate in Campion's strange vision, but it's worth it.
Well, I had the experience of liking the look of the film, and I mean, this is obviously a director with a good eye, and it does make you think in that way. The characters and the story didn't interest me. I mean, I didn't feel their pain. Even in a climactic moment when Sweetie is in terrible distress at the end of the film, I didn't feel anything for her. I thought in a strange way, maybe it's because the film has such a striking look that I was aware that a style was being imposed on characters. There is a beautiful image, and frankly, it really represents Sweetie and some of the other characters in the film, of a tree trying to grow up out of a sidewalk. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's photographed in a lot of different ways right at the top of the film. And that's beautiful, and I'll always remember that. But as far as recommending the film, I can't
do
it.
Well, I don't know that you're supposed to care for Sweetie. I think that Sweetie is supposed to be one of these people that some families have that they just can't stand. You know, the person who basically,
right.
You finally have to write them off as a loss. And the problem is that poor Dad can't do that. I mean, because of guilt and because of the history of Sweetie, they continue to allow this disruptive element to destroy their family. I think that's really what you're supposed to feel, not that you like Sweetie or anything.
Well, I don't think I could like Sweetie, but I guess I saw her as maybe just represent as an artifice within a film.
Now, one of your favorite films is David Lynch's Blue Velvet. You didn't
yes.
see any kind of same
note in terms
here.
Of, I saw the same visual note, absolutely, and that's why I like that part of the film.
Okay.
Coming up next, a melodrama about drugs called The White Girl, Troy Byer from Knots Landing, and the action star known as Timac, co-star. Of the street nicknames for cocaine, and it's a well-intentioned but often amateurish melodrama about an upwardly mobile young black woman who's exposed to cocaine in her pursuit of a job as a TV anchorwoman. Troy Byer from TV's Knots Landing plays the addicted woman.
What do you see as your most difficult problem?
The meaning that I have a problem.
Her boyfriend is played by the action star known as Timac. Everything is beautiful between them before the drugs.
We're going to find that peace of mind.
The film is amateurish when it tries to depict drug hallucinations.
Are you trying to steal my date?
It's just for recreational use.
And naturally, the big finish of the movie involves Timac doing his thing to the drug pusher. I guess the message of that is if you're going to put an action star in a movie, a karate guy, he's going to end up kicking somebody. Like Stanley and Iris, The White Girl means well with its anti-drug message. The film was written and directed by Tony Brown, who for a long time has hosted Tony Brown's Journal on PBS. But the writing is often laughable, or at least very painfully obvious here. There's no reason for this to be a movie. The writing is on the level of a bad TV show where it probably should have played and then might have reached a larger audience. I have trouble suggesting that anyone pay money to see this story.
I agree with you. I did feel, however, there was a lot of sincerity and honesty in the quality of the performances, especially by Troy Byer, who I think was able to deliver a conviction and really throw herself into this role.
Well, that might be the best part of the film. It's her work. I mean,
so
she's hurting, and you can see it.
She's hurting. She wants to make it in television. Her friend is leading her down this garden path. There's a point beyond which she won't go, and there's a morality lesson here that in its own more modern way is the same kind of message that we got 40 years ago, 50 years ago in movies like Reefer Madness.
I was just going to say, it's at the level of a little caricature.
Here comes a nice girl, and look at these terrible things that happen to her, and they will happen to you, of course. Fact is, they will happen to you, and cocaine does do this to people, so the message is completely valid, and I think that eventually it probably will wind up on television, and it will reach a large audience, and it will play there as an effective melodrama.
Well, maybe. I mean, I think if the film were a little more subtle and a little more credible, it would play as a more effective melodrama. So for its good intentions, you know, that doesn't get you into the theater for me.
Okay, let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs down for Stanley and Iris, although I like the chemistry between Robert De Niro and Jane Fonda more than Jane did. Two more thumbs down for Homer and Eddie, with James Belushi and Whoopi Goldberg struggling under the weight of a wildly over-furnished plot. Two more thumbs down for Loose Cannons, the cop buddy movie that hits new lows in an undistinguished field. We disagreed, though, on Tweety. I was impressed by the fresh creative vision of director Jane Campion. Gene only liked her visual style. Finally, two more thumbs down for Tony Brown's The White Girl, despite Troy Meyer's effective performance. So, 9 thumbs down out of 10 this week.
You know, Roger, I'm wondering what's going on out there with these buddy pictures, whether it's man and woman or two cops. I mean, look at these pictures that we just reviewed. They're putting together, it seems like if they can just get the stars in them, they'll settle for anything. These are ridiculous.
Well,
laughable
it's a formula.
Scripts.
It's a formula because the hardest thing to do in writing a movie is to create a new and believable character. And the easiest thing to do is to put together two collections of eccentric human behavior and make them partners and then have their differences clash with each other. That is formula movie making. Stars love it in a way because they get to be in with somebody else they've always wanted to act with, and they don't really have to do too much homework.
They don't have to enter in and create a character because all this stuff is imposed on them. It's like baggage or labels on them. I got this problem in this scene and another problem in another scene. It's not really movie writing. That's it for this week. Next week we'll be back with our annual show in reaction to the announcement this coming Wednesday of the Academy Award nominations. We'll focus on what surprised us, who wasn't and was nominated. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Snow caps, raisinettes, and goobers. 3 box office hits starring Nestle Milk Chocolate. Moviegoers give them a definite 2 thumbs up. KitchenAid double door refrigerator, trash compactor, portable convertible dishwasher, and solid state touch options washer dryer all in almond. KitchenAid for the way it's made. Redken Classics, hair care products formulated to create beautiful, healthy hair. So effective, their formulas transcend time, available exclusively at salons. Travel Savers, the nation's leading chain of independent travel agencies. Consult your Yellow Pages for the Travel Savers agency nearest you. Travel Savers.